Buen día. Soy la doctora Mara Gómez y tengo el gusto de convocarlos ahora al panel 1, Estado de Derecho y Democracia desde la perspectiva de la Justicia. Este panel está integrado por Manuel Delgado Iribarren García Campero,
from the General Courts and Director of the Technical Secretariat of the Electoral Council of Spain.
Mirta Varela Durán,
alternate magistrate from the Electoral Tribunal of Panama.
Patricio Valdés Aldunate, ministro presidente del Tribunal Calificador de Elecciones de Chile.
Minister of the Electoral Qualifying Tribunal of Chile.
Y como presidente de este panel,
Felipe de la Mata Pisaña, magistrate of the High Chamber of the Electoral Tribunal of the Federal Judiciary.
Cedo ahora la palabra. I will now give the floor to the chair of the panel,
Magistrate Felipe de la Mata Pisaña. Please go ahead. Thank you, Mara. I am convinced that this panel number one, called Rule of Law and Democratic Integrity from the Perspective of Electoral Justice, deals with a very important topic to start with the analysis and reflection works that we will be conducting throughout these 2 days. This is why I would like to share with you some questions that we can ask ourselves in this beautiful city of San Miguel de Allende. What do we talk about when you talk about democratic integrity, and what's the relationship between rule of law, electoral justice, and democratic integrity? How do we contribute from the electoral bodies to create rule of law and comprehensive democracy? We mustn't forget that elections are based in two paramount democratic principles, the universal suffrage and political unity that derive from the international and national agreements. So elections are very important for the values such as human rights, like freedom of expression, freedom of speech, the right to participate in the government through legitimate representatives chosen with freedom, right to equality and to public services, because the authority of the government comes from the will of the citizens. And elections are regulated by rules and principles that can only be consolidated with a rule of law. So the juridical framework that really provides accountability of the governments, the effectiveness in drafting laws and acts and respecting human rights. So elections with integrity improve the quality of democracy. So this is a relatively new concept that allows us to understand the electoral process as a whole, to see that all the its elements are met in each one of their stages and in all of them as a whole. For instance, for the requirements to cast the vote, we have the delivery of the vote, the counting the votes, and the oversight of the results. However, it's not just the organizational part. We also have to go to the qualitative area. And I think we cannot ignore this part, because they go hand in hand in order to improve the democratic integrity. So understanding democratic integrity is very easy if we want to work to respect the rights and principles that govern democratic states. So we could start debating and asking questions and answering them, but I won't do that, of course. I know, I think you can tell that I like this topic, so I just wanted to say these things so we can work with the same methodology. We will start with, let's say, 10 minutes each, because we're talking about freedom of expression, so we have to abide by it. So we will have 10 minutes for each one of you, and then we will go to a round of dialogue between all of us in order to draft our conclusions at the end of the panel. So, in order to do this, I would like to give the floor now to Mr. Manuel Delgado Iribarren.
De acuerdo, muchas gracias.
Thank you very much. Within those 10 minutes I have, I would like to spend half a minute to thank the Electoral Tribunal of the Federal Judiciary and also International IDEA and our dear friend Daniel Sobato, who is very constant and defending the basic principles of the election. So I would like to thank you for following up on this and for hosting this great, participating in this great conference, which I'm sure will be as wonderful as the one that was held last year in Manaus. So talking about the rule of law and democratic integrity can allow us to talk about pretty much everything when it comes to electoral justice. And I wanted to be a little bit different. So when I was asked about a specific topic or that I would like to address, I thought that I would talk about something that, even though it's very concrete, it is very current. Based on what many of you have asked me, which is the performance of electoral justice in Spain based on the new separatist movement in Catalonia. So this is a very current topic, as I'm sure you all are aware, but it is such a complex topic, this problem that the Catalan nationalism has started. That we cannot really address right now all of the different channels and all of the different problems. So first I will talk about how the electoral justice and the electoral process is, what it's comprised of in Spain. And then I will talk about what has been done regarding the situation that we're living in Spain. Well, our system in Spain is clearly different compared to most of the other Ibero-American countries. It is based on a complex system of distribution of competences between different public authorities. We have a first step or a first stage, which is just the material management of the elections. That's done by the Ministry of the Interior and the regional council offices for autonomous regions. And then there's a second level, a second tier, which is called the electoral administration, which are our electoral boards. And at the top of them, there is the central electoral board, which is very similar, as far as I understand, as you do it in Chile, which is based on a judicial majority. These are judges from the high court, from the Supreme Court, that are elected randomly. And they choose five representatives. So what is the role and responsibility of these councils, these boards? They have two main duties. Number one, to organize the electoral process, from reviewing the census and counting and so on. But it also has a contentious aspect. The main function assigned by it by the electoral law is the control and we have to guarantee equality in electoral processes, and they can act even in the absence of well-established laws in order to protect this. But there's a third tier. Those decisions of the electoral boards can be reviewed by this administrative law chamber of the Supreme Court. And when it comes to the specific or the main rights, it can also be reviewed by other bodies. So there's many different bodies, and for the system to work, we have to work together, and there has to be a loyalty and respect for the different competences of the different bodies. So this is like the general framework. Now, regarding the Catalan nationalist movement, we don't have time to go into details, but I will try to summarize it, and I will talk about the the attempt of giving juridical coverage to things that don't really apply, because a majority in the parliament, I mean, even though there has been a lot of propaganda, but there was a plan to set a strategy so that the government and the parliament both aim to have a referendum, using all the media and a lot of advertising. And in my opinion, also, there have been efforts to manipulate the people. But from the standpoint of the juridical coverage, because I don't have time to talk about other things, I would say that that majority in the parliament, which was the coalition, the most important pro-independence coalition, which has used the independence as an essential element to contribute to what they think that must be done with the political system, which is eliminated, at least in the liberal democratic model that we understand. And that majority in this final phase, which is the one I would like to highlight, has been done through two legal instruments. One, which is the law of the self-determination referendum, and the second law, which is the law of the juridical transition towards a new republic. These are laws that were not formulated by the government, but by the parliament groups, so that they didn't have to take them into the board of guarantees. And these were done in just one day, without having the possibility of having amendments there too, so which was very, very difficult, in order to avoid the controls of the tribunals that would be able to suspend, to cancel these activities. However, as you probably know, these two laws were suspended by the Constitutional Tribunal that has declared as null and void and opposing the Constitution. So these were acts that were not held, as you know. And of course, what they have achieved is a lot of advertising, even worldwide. So there was a drill, and I say drill because it wasn't a real referendum. And not only because that the law in which this was all based was suspended, but also because of the complete absence of guarantees. And since it was not a legal referendum, the electoral boards weren't able to go in there or to participate, because it wasn't something of a legal nature. And after this drill, some consultations reached the board that allowed it to adopt a resolution, which is the one I wanted to mention, because we're talking about the rule of law and democratic integrity. And it was approved by the board 4 days later, October 4th, 2017. On October 1st, that's when this happened. And then the electoral board, because it is one of the institutions that, I mean, maybe scholars were talking about this in Spain, that went to the House of Representatives. This is one of the institutions that is highly trusted by citizens, and I have heard about it here. They don't call for press conferences. People don't really know who they are, but they act based on the resolutions. And in this resolutions, in this resolution, it's very brief, so I'm going to read it. On October 1st, in Catalonia, no process has taken place that can be considered as a referendum in any of the modalities provided for in the legislation, by the person who wasn't allowed to call for the referendum, and also by the way it was conducted, neither by its object, which was non-constitutional and unconstitutional, and also by because of the absence of transparency in its control. So they have no value, these results have no value, And so this self-determination referendum was not really a referendum. So the proceedings that followed this, what they pretended to do, well, they were based on this act, which fails to fulfill all the guarantees and doesn't abide by the law. There were no councils. The ballots were counted in private. So the Central Electoral Board, what they did is they took advantage of that moment, and by using that authority that not only solves these problems internally but also externally. And I'm sorry because I'm out of time, so I have nothing else to add. Actually, I'm 2 minutes overdue. Only 48 seconds, not 2 minutes, so it wasn't that bad. And I mean, we could stay here talking about that topic for a while. And I was asking if there is any independence movement that is completely constitutional, and also where is the right to vote from the people from Catalonia, from the Catalans? Because if we follow a constitutional regime where you cannot vote for independence, then the question is there a natural right or not? And whether it would imply a constitutional reform in Spain. But I'm sure we will have a lot of fun in the next phase of the panel. So now I would like to give the floor to Mrs. Mirta Varela Dura. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Before anything, I would like to thank the Electoral Tribunal of Mexico for inviting me, and also I'd like to thank International IDEA. We are really proud of being here with you today in this very important conference for the democracy of our countries. I'm going to talk to you about a ruling by the Electoral Tribunal of Panama. These were internal elections within a political party, the oldest political party in Panama, and the one that has the greatest number of participants. This was an internal delegation, and they wanted to choose the delegates, and the delegates are the people that have that are very important in a collective, because they choose the internal authorities. They are very important members of these collectives. So the election was held, and the topic was focused because when the votes were cast and then when they were counted, the due process wasn't followed.
Se hizo una elección en un corregimiento.
There were some mistakes in most of the ballots, and even though this happened, they were counted, the minutes were closed, and then they were scrutinized again. This was due to an appeal, because once that internal route has been already walked, there can be an appeal by the members of the collective that was affected. But first, you have to present the appeal inside the collective. So this was taken to the Electoral Tribunal, and there was a hearing. We heard both parties, the political party, and they have a body, which is a commission that holds the elections in all its phases. We had also the plaintiff, and Eduardo Valdez Escofri was actually there, which is very well known by most people here in the Americans, Magistrate Eduardo Valdez. He was the one who led the process, and at the end the magistrate determined that, ruled that this has breached the law, and it didn't follow due process, and it was outside the legal scope. So at the end of the day, the decision of the Electoral Tribunal, the magistrate Valdez, together with the other two magistrates, was unanimous, a unanimous ruling. First, they nulled this and the proclamation of the winners, and they asked for a recount, and one of the plaintiffs was the winner, and it was clear because of the ruling, and that's what I'm bringing here, the importance of internal democracy within political parties and with the political collectives. We cannot have collectives that don't have integrity, that don't use these practices, and they just want to manipulate the elections, because, okay, if we do general elections, that's what we always ask ourselves in the tribunal. If we do transparent elections, what good will come from that if there are primary elections and candidates do it outside the law? Then there is a big issue there, so we need to emphasize the integrity that has to happen within political parties and political collectives so that due process is followed, because some members of some collectives have the idea that this due process is only at a jurisdictional level before a tribunal, but this is not the case. Due process must be fulfilled from the beginning, from the core of the political party, where they choose their authorities, when they elect their candidates for popular elections, they have to follow due process, providing the guarantees and following all the phases as not to breach or violate the rights of the people. So this was the third time this happened. There were two before this when the tribunal had to step in, and due to this challenge, we would like to highlight the importance of this due process. So we, as a tribunal, walk together with these political collectives. And when they have an election, we are there. And now, based on the law number 29, which was enacted this year, we are we're actually still modifying it. And we will organize and fund and oversee all the elections from all political parties that involve elections, for instance, for delegates to the Congress, primary elections. We will also have a large intervention, a larger compared to what we did before. That it will go from the creating the drafting the regulations, how they need to have the due process, the different phases for the challenges. Everything has to be transparent. They must give opportunities for internal challenges, and this has been a work that has been in the works for years, and this is something that the tribunal, I mean, we feel really proud. Some parties are complaining because they are saying that we are breaching their independence and their faculties, but here in Panama we only have five political parties. All of them are national political parties at a national level. We have two that are new, that we have the FAT and the Alianza, which is the other one. So we will have at least seven political parties. Some others are being formed, are being created, but they are in early stages. So I think we will have the next elections with seven political parties. And this has, they always feel that when the tribunal is with them in an internal process, they usually feel that there are fewer challenges, the members are trust the results more, and I think this is why, I mean, because of this work, teaching them, training them,
haciéndoles que participen de una cultura,
and helping them to participate in a more democratic culture where we follow due process and elections are done in a transparent manner. And we have left behind the practice of stealing ballots or people stealing the ballot boxes. This has been left behind, and I'm smiling right now because we have now regulated with the reform a practice that was happening in the collectives in the general elections, and what was happening, well, now the vote will be void when the ballot has any kind of symbol, any kind of mark. Why? Because they were buying votes with this. So at the end, when they count the votes, they would tell them, okay, write down a symbol or a flower, or draw a flower. Now we have decided in the reform that the ballot that is scratched will be void. We have had to reach those actions because it was really, really having an impact on the elections, and these were practices that we can't really allow, besides the decency that we must have in a democracy. So I just wanted to tell you about this ruling. I think it is interesting because we need to continue to support the internal democracy of political parties, because the tribunal, the assembly, they issue the regulations, and they kind of bypass the law. Some political parties try to look for formulas to do so, and it's amazing really how they do it. So we have to be very creative. And now with the campaigns and with this new electoral reform that we have in Panama, that they have been approved, I was telling one of my colleagues here that it is very difficult to go to the details and try to see which can be the possible things that can be done in the future in campaigns and practice. So it will be done, it will have to be done by the jurisprudence. But we need to make sure that there is not a breach of the freedom, like freedom of speech, freedom of expression, and the different rights, as not to violate, allow people to violate these rights. So we have a lot of work to do still in Panama. We are, we have new budget caps, donation caps. We are trying to build more pillars regarding transparency and accountability at the point that magistrates, they have undertaken a series of training sessions throughout the country, and because we have to have a cultural change, a mindset change. We must advocate for accountability and transparency. I think I'm out of time, so that would be it for me. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Madam Magistrate. When I was listening to this Panama case, I was remembering of a ruling in the year 2005 where this electoral this tribunal precisely entered to the life of the political parties, to say it some way, and all the discussion that started back then. So I think that this result has been very positive, because finally the constitutional reform of the year 2007 was acknowledged, and it was acknowledged that the possibility that the electoral tribunal can participate in the trials for the protection of the political rights of the citizens. That and maybe it's going to have a branch which is very original in the political parties. I should say that it could be called the trial of the voters. But this is a very interesting topic. Now I am going to give the floor to Mr. Patricio Valdez Aldunante. Thank you very much, Magistrate. I'm not going to have orders here, because Alberto changed the topic when I was out of the city for a trip. But it's that I think that it's much more interesting, this one. So the thing is that from our standpoint, democratic integrity coming from electoral justice is how the citizenship, how the tribunal is exerting this in our country. What's the origin? I'm going to read something that it's very important, of the year 1988, which says as follows. Mr. Victor Riva, the president or the chair of the Electoral Tribunal, by means of this letter, I am referring to this and that number letter, and I am informed about the results of the counting carried out on October 5th of this year. I am witnessing that before this tribunal, my thankfulness for the work that you did and the abidance that you have to the legal provisions that are in force. I would like to tell you about I would like to congratulate you, and it was undersigned by Mr. Augusto Pinochet, who was the president back then. So I question you, what do you think that somebody that has exerted the presidency of a military government for 17 years, why do you think that he abided automatically by the result that was done by this electoral qualificator tribunal? To me, it is very simple. This tribunal, since 1995, and we have kept the same membership, more or less, has never had problems in the result of the elections. Why? Mainly because of how it is composed. I mean, the members that they have, for example, this is of a constitutional origin. We are four ministers of the Supreme Court that I selected by draw or by lot, and it's not because I'm the smartest or the more handsome, but because I am the senior one. And then we have an ex-politician that has been a chair or a vice chair of the Chamber of Representatives, and that it's not a politician anymore. So the truth is that this is great because they are going to provide us with a lot of service because they know politics very good. So what happens? This tribunal is not done because spontaneously we thought that it was going to be made by all these people. But as of the Constitution of 1828, there was an indirect electoral system like the one you have in the United States, more or less. So in all of the elections, we were experiencing problems because in one, for example, there was not an absolute majority, so the Congress has to elect, and that Congress was made by the four brothers of one of the candidates. So they discussed if they were able or not to vote because this was a personal matter or a public matter. So definitely they determined that they were able to vote because it was a public matter. So in 1925, Arturo Alessandri Parma, who was the president when they issued that constitution, because in Chile, no constitution has been created or originated in the way that the previous constitution set forth, but this has been a result of a situation where they have broken the law or breached the law, so that's why 1980, 1925, 1933, but all of these are modifications that have been done as per what the constitution sets forth in the current constitution that was issued during Pinochet administrations. It's undersigned by Ricardo Lago, the current president, but all these situations have set for that Chile is a republic where we respect legality. As in all the countries, we have had some matters of military government, and the longest one that we had was the one of General Pinochet that lasted 17 years. But before these situations, we haven't had problems because of the result of a presidential election. There was one that we had a discussion about, a little discussion about a candidate to the Senate, but it was absolutely, I mean, they were not right. So they so previously, when we didn't have an absolute majority in the presidential election, the full Congress had to elect. But nowadays, we have a second one. So in, we count, score, and we appoint the president of the country, and nobody can say anything to us. So, for example, if I am the minister of the Supreme Court, what I do in the election tribunal is absolutely independent, and they cannot, the Constitution cannot intervene, not the Supreme Court, no one can intervene, and nor even the Supreme Court. So, from our standpoint, we feel satisfied, and as I was mentioning previously, no one knows, and Dr. Sobato can certify this, no one knows that we exist, because we haven't had any issue. Nevertheless, when you said that you had some issues because the perception in Chile had dropped because the Electoral Service, which is an administrative body, has made some decisions that do not correspond. For example, the last one for this election that is going to be in 10 or 11 more days, there was an issue with two political parties. And the Electoral Service, maybe because they were because of the construance of the law, because the construance has to be very legal. I mean, so they determined that those parties cannot be enrolled, and they don't have this first instance body, so they make post a claim, and we had to determine who had or if they can enroll it as a political party. And that was the end of the problem. I mean, they cannot do anything else in this regard. So I think that electoral justice has to determine, I mean, because they cannot create different laws. I mean, that's why the executive and the legislative powers are there, so we have to abide by what they say, and we have to construe, to interpret the law. We act as a jury, but we rule by law. So, and we have to use the critique for this, I mean, the experience, the general accepted principles, etc., etc. So, from our tribunal, we feel very satisfied, and I think that the citizenship is also satisfied. Why? Because they don't know about us. So here, there is no, as the magistrate was saying, that 50% and 50%, and you can be prestigious enough because you are a judge. This is not true, because this could be true when there is like a competence, okay? But I always ask myself, what would they say if we rule against or in favor of someone? But in this subject matter, I think that we have quite a good system that has almost 100 years, and no one has discussed if it has to exist or stop existing. So they are asking us for independence, and to do the things abiding by the Constitution and the laws. Thank you very much. I'm sorry that I had no order in my presentation. I'm sorry, my friend, because you changed my presentation, the topic of my presentation. Thank you very much. The truth is that to make comparisons of this experience is very interesting. We have never doubted the results of the presidential elections in Chile, and with 100 years of existence of this system, it is quite respected by the citizens. And this power of this election tribunal which is a little bit double, which reminds me what remembers me what was happening in this the tribunal here in the, for the election of the president, which is an exception for the rest of the elections in Mexico. But well, we are going to go to the next stage, which is the debate. So the organizing committee is asking me for only to have only 20 minutes, but I would like to ask them for 25, please, because this is a very interesting topic. So I open the floor for the discussion.
Bien, gracias, buenas.
Well, thank you, and good afternoon.
Alejandro Avante, de México.
Alejandro Avante, Mexico. I would like to pose a question that personally creates a concern on me. There is a constant in human practices, in all human activities, to make simpler to have access, the fact of having access to services, decision making, and participation. Unfortunately, in this electoral subject matter, we are a little bit absent of this circumstance. We continue voting as in the previous century. And currently, the mechanisms to provide or to get the citizens closer to this and all the huge companies, as Daniel Sobato was mentioning, all the huge companies have designed strategies to make the citizens close to the experience and to make this not an act but an experience, for example, to buy certain brand or to attend to certain trip or to know certain city. And it seems to be that in the electoral area we are back in time. And I would like to pose this question because I think that this has fostered a huge challenge that we have, which is to overcome this laziness. So how can we contribute in order to inhibit the apathy of the citizens in order not to conclude only with a goal, because maybe this is a result of some other countries, the policies of the other countries, and but to face democracy, because when they say that they obtain a goal, they obtain an immediate benefit. So how much should we contribute in order to reinforce the fact that democracy is a lifestyle, in which is the role that the judges are playing, not only the decision-making process, but in promoting in all the voters that are going to decide in the future, and I'm referring to the children, for a democracy. What can we do in order to create this cultural change? I am convinced that nobody is prone for democracy because many generations have seen a mechanism to elect governance, but not in order to make decisions that are representative for them and for their lifestyle. How can we, the judges, contribute in order to support democracy from this standpoint? Thank you very much. Are there any other comments? Please. Good morning to all of you, and thank you for giving me the opportunity of sharing with you this very special moment. My name is Miriam Cristal from the Electoral Tribunal of Paraguay. I would like to share with you some rulings that we have had, which are very specific and very peculiar, and the way that they were solved and who are they directed to. We had a specific case where a representative was a part of the Chamber of Representatives without being a representative. So they make null all these elections, but afterwards
pasó al Tribunal Electoral.
The resolution went to the Electoral Tribunal,
a la Corte Suprema de Justicia,
then to the Supreme Court of Justice,
pasaron los cinco años y este señor,
and then the 5 years, and he was within the parliament because of this preventative measure that he filed. And the chamber was also an accomplice, and they didn't even pay attention to the court ruling. Specifically, we have another case, a recent case, the trial of the former president, Mr. Nicanor Duarte Frutos, who was elected with the most votes, and the chamber never allowed him to take office because they didn't have the quorum for when he had to swear. So with this court resolution, with the resolution of the tribunal, but never during these years that he was in office, he never attained the quorum, and he had the great amount of votes in history. So we have such a different specificities in each country, where we, the judges, sometimes our rulings are not met because of these political constraints. And almost as Dr. Mirta was telling you, the issues that we have are in the primary elections, in the primary elections of the parties, because when we, the election administrators, are the ones that are the orchestra directors, we don't have any issues, but our issues are coming from the inside of the parties. So obviously, this has a repercussion in the citizens, from which they are part of. I wanted to share this because it seems to me that it's an interesting situation. Thank you very much. We continue to have the floor open. Thank you, please.
Gracias.
Thank you very much.
También a propósito de las elecciones internas,
I would like, once that we are speaking about internal elections, I would like to make reference to a situation which is legalized in Mexico. Even besides the fact that this self-determination principle of the political parties was accepted and the authorities cannot intervene, but in the cases where it is provided by law, this circumstance that it is identified as reserved information, the information that they have in the service, and there are political institutes that carry out their selection, the candidate selection procedures, and they have the bylaws, even though they are compelled to have these regulations. A certainty goes in the benefit of their own members about the election of the candidates and the governance, and they have used these invitation letters to regulate them in each case. So this is something that seems to me that matches with what Eduardo Garcia calls the political instrumentalization of the Constitution. How do we understand this constitutional principle in order to use them in favor of the political stakeholders? And this is something that we are going to have on the table in the very near future, immediately in this service matter. And besides, if we take into consideration the principles that we have mentioned, the certainty, objectiveness, transparency, in Mexico we also have provided this by the Constitution, the maximum publicity, and how all these parts of the puzzle in the law play the game in the case of the internal democracy of the political parties, and how this lack of definition and lack of knowledge of the rules of the game are going to operate in order to render some results that are not going to be consistent with which what we are expecting from the political institutions themselves. Thank you very much. We still have a little bit of time.
motivado por la intervención que me precedió.
Motivated by the last intervention, there is a debate about if we should regulate the way the survey companies act in how they publish their results in such a way that they forbid that the political stakeholders may be included in these surveys or in these political actions before the elections. So in the first election of Homer, you can have different circumstances, objective circumstances, because many people voted and we expected less votes. But in Uruguay, for example, in the last national elections, the errors were 8 and 9%, and this of course make the suspicion that if the survey companies were playing a role of biasing the public opinion. So I just wanted to set this on the table so that we can reflect on it. Should we really know what they are doing? I mean, this is a question. I mean, should we really oversee what these companies are doing? This is a question that I want to leave on the table. Are there any other comments? So we are going to close, and we are going to give the floor to Mr. Manuel Delgado Delgado. Okay, I will try to speak as a telegram, but I wanted to mention all the points in a very summarized way. First of all, with the provocation of these magistrates, of course that we can change the constitution. The problem is that we have to change it in accordance to the constitutional procedures. Otherwise, we have to defend it. Of course, in Article 2 of the Spanish Constitution, it speaks about the autonomy of the regions and the very important basic principles. So obviously this can be done. Moreover, the parliament in Catalonia has the power to start this reform procedure as a parliament. So this majority could have started this procedure, but they are not willing to do it. But this more important topic is that in a democratic state where the territory has a exceptional political autonomy that is not given in all the European territories, like for example Germany doesn't have it. So under this situation, the secession of part of a territory affects all the territory, even thinking of a small detail. What they consider, those that are independentists or pro-independence, a majority of what they, I mean the people that live in Catalonia, they can affect what, they can decide what is going to impact everyone. The system is so absurd, but like for example, if you get, you have just gotten there, that you are able to be vote, and many families of with eight last names cannot vote because they are working in Madrid or Bilbao or whatever, and they don't have the right to vote. Only those that are living or residing in that area. Now, regarding the thing of the quorum. In our parliament, the quorum is a decision quorum, not an attendance quorum, and we prevent this kind of issues. And to make a decision, we can do it, but we have had this problem with the city halls. There have been lots of mayors that have tried to do this. Once this the mayor Casa is not in office anymore, then what are they going to do? Besides all the judiciary actions, we opted by a double way. First of all, the tribunal says that there is no need of having a quorum in order to inform, because this is not a decision-making process. But second, in this kind of situations, this wave can be given to before this board, and with this they are hindering this process. Now, regarding the surveys, the electoral law in Spain is very rigorous, very stringent, and it is regulated in a very clear manner. The most important sanctions in Spain are precisely because of that, not because they make a mistake in the elections, which is not possible, but for the stringent compliance of the objective hard data. Otherwise, the electoral board opens some files, and they say, for example, that the survey say this or that. So in that cases, they have a control and they have very stringent processes. Now I am going to give the floor to Mrs. Mirta Varela.
When we speak
about institutional integrity and rule of law, when we speak about the electoral tribunals or the electoral authorities, I think that in the first place they have to set by example transparency, congruence, and I think that strength and that credibility that the electoral tribunal is setting by example is going to be branched out to the political parties if we make them understand what the importance of the integrity, clarity, transparency, and accountability. We have to continue working in this. Because of one of your comments regarding the fact that what can the electoral bodies can do, I think that one of the pillars that the electoral tribunal has set forth is education. In regarding values, I think that education as a fundamental tool for change, to allow evolution of human beings, is paramount. And because we, the tribunal, promote debates and the training courses, etc., because first of all, you have to study what you are going to talk about. You have to respect, because tolerance is important, because you need to be tolerant towards the way of thinking of other people. And we have to promote this through debates, through student debates, calling all the youth so that they have spokesmen, that they are part of these national issues. After every election, we observe how young people are not participating in these elections. We have less and less young people participating. So we think that they do not care about all these politics, and this is a macro issue. The low credibility that the political parties in the world, when they have opened the wide door to these independent candidacies for not only for presidents, for representatives, for all the positions. So this is kind of a black cloud on our heads, because we have had very few good experiences with the independent candidates, because most of them that have that are representatives and now can become presidents do not have a political party. I mean, how did you cheat all your voters, in regardless of the fact that you are part or not of part of a political party? Only one woman continues to be independent, and she is trying to collect signatures to become the president of our country. So I think that we have to continue by building all this education, and we have to set by example. We have to be, we have to promote this legitimacy. We have to work on it. It's not an easy job. We have to work with well-founded the rulings that are congruent, and it's important for the tribunal to educate, to explain. We are in the process of issuing a reform to explain to the population so that they understand that there is no this secrecy, that there is that we are hand in hand with the population, with the citizens. Of course, we also have the magistrates; they are have been devoted to this. But we also have a center of studies, a democratic studies. It's important to highlight the education and the importance to convey education so that they are understood. They can understand the new changes and how are we going to change our mindsets. So I think that integrity has to start with us and also end by the electoral body. So Mr. Patricio Balcázar is going to close this round table.
Based on what I heard here, I think that the farther the political parties are in politics are from elections, are from the appointment of the members of the electoral justice and electoral services and electoral bodies, I think that's the best thing that can happen in order to maintain the independence of these bodies, of these institutions. I think that will be a guarantee of seriousness, and definitely all the population and all the citizens will be happy with that, or would be happy with that. Second off, you were also talking about the tribunals that maybe would have to participate in matters regarding education of all students and so on. I don't think that is the task of electoral bodies. That is the duty and the obligation of the state through public or private education, of having civic education in all schools. At least in our case, lately, that hasn't been the case. That hasn't happened. I think that has to be one of the main obligations of the state through the ministries or the departments of education, so that the kids, even from kindergarten, they start teaching them about civic education. I think that what we used to have in our time, that doesn't exist today anymore, that's what made people become interested in politics, to incentivize the youth and so on. Today there's some kind of anarchy in that regard, and people are born with that anti-system feeling. So that, from my very personal point of view, that would be very good if we could reverse that trend in all our countries. Okay, so with this, we would close this panel, and I will give Mara the floor. Thank you very much. We would like to thank the members of the panel, and I would like to invite the members of the second panel to come to the front, so we can start with panel number two, electoral justice, when facing the new challenges of money in politics. Thank you very much.